5 seconds remaining.
About a minute 6 remaining here. As they've got their Lashrak, they've got their clockwork, they've got the ogre. Wouldn't be surprised to see Sirius go with the Skywrath Mage. Because it should be ogre 5, clockwork in the offlane. Lashrak maybe mid, could go safe lane as well. Gives you pushing potential. Maybe you want Shadow Shaman to be your 4. Still available. Gives you Serpent Wards to work with, as well as a Hex. But they'll show the Gyrocopter, and that puts Lashrak mid, Gyro 1, Clock 3, Ogre 5. So they still need their 4 position. While Ehome, they're looking to grab, I would say, their safe laner. Because they've got their mid in Death Prophet. They're 5 in the Treant. They're 4 in the Zeus. And then the Earthshaker offlane. So 3, 4, 5, your supports. And then your mid for Death Prophet. We'll see what they ban out, though. I could definitely see Shadow Shaman being the choice here. Considering he adds a lot to your push. Gives you that and there it is. Gives you that control, and there he is. There he goes. Very easily guessable there, because it works, and that's what we've been seeing. Bloodseeker gets banned there from Team Sirius, taking away the silence, taking away from the right clicks and the mobility that Bloodseeker gives, as well as when you're gonna be hit with that rupture and have the Death Prophet on top of you, like life just gets hard. So now that you need a 4 position, you could go to that Skywrath if you want to lead the life of silences and damage with the Arcane Bolt, as well as the Mystic Flare at level 6. Go the Jinq route, and you could throw the Mystic Flare on top of the cogs. So it does work here. You've got the damage. Like I like it with the silence, especially against the Zeus. If you hookshot and get on the Zeus, then you're really in for some potential damage. So I wouldn't be surprised to see the Skywrath Mage here. And they go TA. So that changes the lineup. That moves TA mid, Gyro safe lane, Lashrak 4, or it's Lashrak off lane, Clock 4, Ogre 5. So that keeps it still very open, but I would assume it's Lashrak off lane, or Lashrak 4, Clockwork off lane.
10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
So now we're looking at, what Ehome are going to take last. Again, they need their safe laner. Lycan already banned, as is the Bloodseeker, the Void. A lot of options ready for you, and you want to be able to go up against his Templar Assassin. The Kunkka already banned, so you need something that's gonna really round up your lineup, something that works with the Death Prophet as well as the Zeus. We've not seen much Sven. I don't entirely think it's the right pick here. Maybe they go to something like a Jug. Gives you that Blade Fury, that Omni Slash. You can open up some space for him to farm. He could work here with the Death Prophet in terms of pushing. I wonder if the Death Prophet build is still the same, where you're going like Yules and Eggs, just to have the ability to continue to push and output that heavy damage. And then you've got the save of the Treant, the lockdown there. And they go Razor. So Razor safe or Razor off? Razor safe or Razor mid, and it's Razor mid. It's Death Prophet safe lane, leaving Jinq on the Zeus in the 4, off lane Earthshaker, and 5 position Treant, like I said. But this puts D-Stones mid on the Templar Assassin, Doodle safe lane on the Gyro, 4 position Lashrak, off lane Clockwork, and 5 Ogre, like I was thinking. So Yeah. I'm not sure I like this razor. Your lockdown is relying on the fissure and roots and overgrowth. Like, you don't have a lot to keep them close, but you don't have to have that once you've got your mobility and your speed. So we'll see what they're able to do. And it makes it difficult for D-Stones to just kind of sit there and meld. So we'll see. So, D-Stone's on the TA, definitely going to have a lot better of a time here than he did on the Rubick. It's a real mid-hero. Doodle on the safe lane, Gyrocopter, a little bit different than that anti-mage that, you know, he was just trying to get some space and do what he can. Work with what he was given. Unfortunately, it didn't work out.
Prepare for battle.
Shocking.
So, here we go. No. I don't know if you guys can hear my my puppy. He's like 4 months old. He's the cutest little thing. I should post more pictures of him. But he has put a smile on my face and really made hard times easier. And he's great. I love him. Yeah. Hoping he doesn't bark loud enough that you guys can hear it. But if he does, he's adding to the cast. Actually, what he's saying is he thinks Ehome's gonna win. So we'll see if his predictions are right. That would mean that he's a better predictor than Kyle. I mean, right away. You know, I heard him. I heard him say it. Ehome's gonna win. So how are these lanes setting up for Ehome? They've got Innocence going down bottom with Faith Beyond. Is the Zeus going to be there as well? Yeah, they've got three heroes here. And leave the Death Prophet solo for now. I would assume that one rotates once the bounties are picked up, but they're going to secure both bottom bounty runes. VT faded up here by himself. No rotation just yet. But it's all about the surprise factor. Like, they don't know at the moment whether Innocence is going to be here or top. So, you know, they can definitely shock someone, get a root, and turn that into a kill, especially with Faith Beyond here in the trees. So it's going to be the fissure. You know, they're hoping that this kind of moves up. But now you're showing the Zeus, which means Faith Beyond is in a different position. He's supposed to be here, but they'll get the fissure. They should be able to get the kill, and they will. Innocence gets it with that long melee range. Okay, and then you TP out, so it works out. So moving Innocence over, unknowingly into a lane that's already got a sentry ward there and looking for him. Does he have a sentry of his own? He does. So he's just got to try and get this into the right spot. And they know where he's walking. And if they've looked at his inventory, they know he's got a sentry ward at the ready. He needs to get across, but that's really smart. They take away those trees, make sure he can't hide, and now he's going to be dead. This is going to make it really hard for them to get rid of this sentry ward. Because he can't get there in viz, he can't really get rid of it too reliably. And that is the smart move by taking out those trees around it. Pretty genius, actually.
Regeneration.
I click. So, taking a look over mid, You've got the Razor of 897 up against D-Stones on the TA, and it's a 9-6 to 5-2 right now. 897 having a really good time over in the mid lane at the moment. We'll see if it continues to stay that way, and as well as if anybody's going to rotate over. They don't exactly have the best rotating supports, as Innocence is going to fall again here top. I don't think really either of the supports can come over to help, so this will be a 1v1 at least from the perspective of Ehome, where the difference lies. You could bring HYM over, or you could bring Mad to try and stun the Razor. Now, he's going to be a little bit speedy. He'll also get the static link out, so maybe you could turn it if you bring a hero in. I assume this will stay this way, this lane. And the Quelling Blade, you know, continuing to take away these trees and make it harder for Innocence to have an impact. VT faded, taking a lot of damage here from Guevara. He gets the heal, goes in too deep, and he'll die to Innocence. So he doesn't need the trees to hide in. You just put yourself a little bit too deep, and you'll end up dying regardless. Not the best move there. And I wonder what the Jing Q build will be this time. You know, he's very renowned for his ability to get farm in this 4 position. We used to see it a lot when he was on Serenity. He would be playing the tiny move around, and that was during a time when your 4 was very mobile. Not to say 4s aren't mobile still, but there was a point in time where you would just run around as a 4 and continue to get kills. You'd see like Tusk and Tiny and all the, you know, those heroes that can make something happen. Earth Spirit. It was a big time for Bobaga as a player as well. Homing missile hits, Rocket Barrage comes in, they'll get the kill into Jing Q. So, you know, that's what he's known for, you know, Jing Q securing that farm in the 4 position. So it'll be interesting to see how he progresses and how he does. But Innocent's continuing to come up here, and they're continuing to clear out these trees. Again, you need to be careful. They've got the cogs once more, and VT faded in trouble. Sirius really putting the pressure on in all these lanes. Mad dying to Jing Q, but they go for Guevara for a second, and they will not be able to lock him down. Tithe to the impurities. Earth's bounty. Damage coming out here on Doodle. But, you know, no worse for the wear. 4-3, even so far. VT faded, working with this clarity. Not anymore, as HYM takes it out. How's this mid matchup going? 30-13 to the 21-5 of the TA, so behind about a half level. What I'm going to like about this Treant is he'll be able to heal these towers. So if you don't commit to these towers and get them taken out, which I think they can do with the Lashrak when he's got the Diabolic Edict, as he almost goes down over mid, you know, if you don't take those towers, they're going to get healed up.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's structures are fortified.
Death Prophet doing well at 37-3. You like to see VT Faded get off to a hot start, and we'll be going into that Yule's. What's on its way? Two clarities and a belt of strength. Okay. And then phase boots picked up here for Guevara. He's going to be trying to run up on these heroes and lock them into the cogs. Meanwhile, Fissure comes out. Faith Beyond in a bit of trouble. Here comes Jing Q as well as Innocence. And Mad is probably gonna fall here. They won't go in on a Doodle Innocence running away. And should be able to get back to the bounty area, trying to go invis and will. So now Doodle, unable to find the Treant, who's just gonna run and find himself near a shrine with a Zeus. So they don't get the kill there. In return, Ehome find themselves one. And that's with the help of this Zeus, who's now going and getting close to the Arcane Boots. 897 taking a lot of damage. D-Stone's destroying him. HYM falls. BT Faded is here, so they'll try to trade on D-Stones. They've got a lot of damage coming in, and there are the ghosts. Oh, Refraction! Oh! 21 health! God. It gets closer, that's for sure.
Regeneration.
But that was dangerously close. Faith Beyond getting rocked up with Rocket Barrage. Mad and Doodle will give chase. But again, they've got the heal from Innocence. Meanwhile, Jin Q over mid. Guevara comes in, and that's without the hookshot to grab that kill on Zeus. Guevara will heal up here, and again opening it more for BT Faded, who's going into the Yules, and then a Medallion. I wonder when the Axe comes out. I'm not too familiar with the builds on the Death Prophet these days, but Doodle getting low. He ends up dying. The call down is there. They've also got Guevara coming in. Doesn't use the hookshot. Gets the kill on a Mad. Looks, or gets the kill on a Faith Beyond. Looks over at Jin Q as they lose Mad to 897. Plasma Field, damage out, HYM dead, Guevara on the run, thinks about reinitiating with the hookshot, starts the battery assault, and mixes it on Jin Q. Sorry for the word fumble there.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Got the cogs around Innocence. They'll get the kill. Guevara leading to a lot of kills here. 10 minutes in, we'll switch it to the net worth. We see that BT Faded leads, but closely followed by this Clockwork. And the game's sitting pretty even, which is nice to see Sirius kind of turning it around. You know, despite being last in the groups, they have shown they have a little bit of promise. I would have liked for their team to stick with the last year's iteration, but maybe that team will turn and find a different sponsor. Who knows? Faith Beyond have. He's going first item Ags. We see this a lot. It's the debate on whether or not to go Blink or Ags. I guess Ags gives you a reliable lead with the totem. Which isn't terrible. And I think not against the Morphling. Feels a lot better.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Meanwhile, VT Faded. Still on that Yules. Has 1,000 gold saved up, needs another 650 afterwards, so needs 300 gold to get to that Yules. And then Jin Q, 2-0 Talisman's going into a third. I mean, he's happy with that. It's also, I think, had the gold for Arcane Boots, but elected to go 2-0 Talismans instead, which is an interesting little change there. Or, decision change there, should I say.
Radiant's
897 going down to D-Stones. Getting the kill. Who's actually got that blink dagger? I didn't realize these stones had the blink dagger. Echo Slam coming in from Faith Beyond. I don't know about that. D-Stones gets the double kill, looking for VT Faded. They're going to commit to this. VT Faded on the run inside the base, getting the heals from the tree and protecting the melt strike. Oh, D-Stones, what have you done? Oh, boy. Ooh. Oh! D-Stones! That was amazing! Wow. I mean, you commit that hard. Usually you pay. Oh god, my voice is fried. But usually you pay. And these stones. Nope. I'm out. I'm good.
Dire's structures are fortified. Dire's top tower is under attack. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Jesus, like that was very impressive. Hookshot on Innocence. Unbeknownst to Guevara, they were trying to get VT faded there. Three-man silence, and now a good fissure. A lot of damage being done, but no follow-up. I was talking about it before. Their lack of catch is... it hurts their output here. Uh-oh. HYM. We'll just run away from the situation. You know, if he's got the ags there, maybe closes the gap, but difficult overall. Not a lot here for 8-9-7, it feels like. Going into a BKB first. Got the static link. They look for HYM. They'll use the overgrowth to get this kill. Guevara comes in with the battery assault. Yeah, an 897 with 80 extra damage. Looking to get a kill here onto the clockwork. Plasma Field comes in. And they will get the kill with the Thunder God's Wrath. So, 2-for-1 and the tip from VT faded to Guevara. A good little turnaround there from Ehome. Worth quite a bit of gold there for the Zeus as well. So Jin-Q always finding farm. Not really surprised.
Radiant's top tower is under attack. Radiant's top tower has fallen.
This is what happens when you don't take these towers. They just get regened up by Innocence. And make sure you grab them. Faith Beyond 1,000 gold away from grabbing him that axe. Picking up that four staff, which is going to be great against this clockwork to make sure you're able to get out of the cogs. Meanwhile, stun comes out, fissure hits, D-Stone's in, melt strike onto Faith Beyond, but there's the Echo Slam, and again, not really feeling it. It gets thrown, it's in a decent spot, but other than that, not much more to it, and now they've got the hook shot. Guevara locking him up to get hit by the split earth, and Sirius. Grab two serious kills right there, and maybe a third. Jin-Q four staffs back.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
They will grab a tower too.
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
So, 14-10, 2,000 net worth here, lead here for Sirius. innocence forced to use the overgrowth. I'm not certain he should have just used it like that. It's a pretty long cooldown at 100 seconds level 1. And again, that's a bulk of the catch that Ehome has. Now, of course, Faith Beyond's going to be trying to get this Zags and has been working on it for a while. And once he gets it, the Totem's going to help out with that. But still, at the same time, it is very difficult overall to find any catch on Ehome. Dust down on Innocence. Looking for the stun, giving chase. Creeps coming over. D-Stone's looking to help. And Dust will last long enough to get the kill. The only mystery is how you lack. D-Stone's playing much better on TA than he did on the Rubick. Blink Deso, 5-0-2 sitting top of the net worth. And I think Sirius, they have a lot better team comp here. And it's from the draft where Ehome have found themselves in a bit of trouble. And they've got the Yules, they'll find Guevara, they'll get the kill. But again, you know, is that kill enough? Is killing off Clockwork worth it? I mean, any kill is worth it, it's just more, you know, how much more do they have to do to finally feel back into this game? Finishing this BKB for the gyro. Now, are they going Ags on this gyro afterwards? They should. I mean, they'll have the BKB now. Should be happy with what Doodle's got in terms of farm. Not too far behind the Razor, but to the counterpart of the Death Prophet ahead. So, you know, things are nice in that aspect. And D-Stone's, you know, he's getting closer and closer to that BKB as well. Smoke coming out from Ehome. We'll see if they find anybody. And they've got the Fissure and now the Totem over, but they're blocked out. D-Stone's able to run away, or has he? Totem again. They might need the Thunder God's Wrath. They don't throw it. And D-Stone survives. Now they need to be on the run. They look for the hook shot, charged up twice, not thrown just yet. Looking for an opportunity potentially. And Fissure again coming in. They've also got the Totem. Hookshot was back to D-Stones to keep himself alive. He doesn't have that reinitiation as he doesn't have Axe, so the cooldown is normal. Nobody dying. They'll deny the tower, so not going entirely well for Ehome, who might look to re-engage. They've got the Echo Swam coming through. Faith Beyond gets the kill on HYM. They've got the Static Link as well as the 4-step forward. Doodle in trouble. Innocence dies to D-Stones. Doodle able to survive, and now D-Stones is the one on the run. Fissure hits, Totem goes, and they'll get the Aegis, and they lock him down. Totem lined up, the damage there, oh! Yeah, they got him. Six times spree, of course, going in the hands of Jin-Q, who always finds his farm. Going into the Ags next. So So 16-13, not a great fight from Sirius. D-Stone's getting taken out for the first time this game. You know, working on that BKB, that could be the difference maker at the moment. And then you've got the pipe for Lestrak to eat a lot of that magic damage coming out. You know, things will change with the next couple of items coming through for the side of Sirius. And if you're Ehome, you need to be ready for that. Rock it on. Cleaning up with that Quelling Blade. Another smoke attempt here. Ehome looking for a shot. Echo Slam up in 20. They've got the Thunder God's Wrath. That's going to get them some vision as they'll spot HYM out. And should be able to get the kill and will.
Don't take that magnitude.
So they take a quick kill onto the Lestrak. And they're building off this. They've got themselves Exorcism ready. I wonder if they'll immediately use it on the Tier 2 here. Or if they'll wait to potentially get to the Tier 3 and Force. So do they go for more and use the Exorcism? Doesn't look like it. They've got the Axe finished. So big pickup. Innocence will eat the homing missile. They'll use call down. They don't get the kill here onto the Treant. And he's just making more space for his team. And Ehome have started to bring it back. They've now got themselves a little bit of a net worth lead. Jinq not too far off that Axe. He'll have Nimbus in a moment. Also close to level 15. And things are really going well when your Zeus is sitting right behind your Earthshaker. And maybe you'd like Faith Beyond to have a little bit more farm, but it's not the worst feeling in the world to get Jinq up to his Axe. Hookshot comes in, but they've got the heal. Now Totem on top. Gavara in a really bad spot. Silenced and killed. Another gank gone wrong for Sirius. A little in front of his team there, and that causes the issues, and they're going to grab a second, taking out the Ogre of Math. Just not going well for Sirius in those aspects, but again, D-Stones, he's got himself this 10-second BKB, yet to use it. Has the Dragonlance next. Almost there. Gyro almost to that Manta. Lestrak going into Guardian Greaves as he finishes off Radiant's that pipe. Middle tower is under attack. D-Stones showing forward. They've got the Totem as well as Echo Slam. Fissure hits. Totem there. Not, and now they've got the Nimbus. Will force the BKB. And that is a good way to get that 10-second charge out away from that BKB from the hands of D-Stone. Well done. Even at 16, even game here 27 minutes in. And Jinq will spot Sirius coming around on them. Drop down the Nimbus. They've got the heal. Fissure blocks him out as well. BKB's going to be Popeye 897 looking over at Mad. And no static link onto the Ogre. We'll actually just whack him till he dies. And Razor, well, he's okay with that. Maybe we would have liked the damage. Maybe you could convert this into even more. but backing off and staying away for the moment.
Incoming!
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Fissure coming out. Now they've got the Nimbus. BKB's getting popped here by Doodle. They'll give chase. They've got the Silence Hook over the Lushrak. Chasing him down. VT Faded has a lot of damage. Now the Totem once again. They've got the Yules out on the Clockwork. And the Cogs, but Faith Beyond continuing to give chase. Man with the Fire Blast stuns him up. Plasma Field coming over. Fissure lands and the Totem. And they've just locked up Guevara. They get the kill. The cooldowns use D-Stones looking for an opening, but won't find it. Man's going to be the next one to drop. Three heroes gone here on the side of Sirius. Ehome taking full advantage and will work with this exorcism to continue to push on through.
Radiant structures are fortified. Dire structures are fortified. Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's middle tower has fallen.
So maybe Sirius has one fight left in him. We'll see if they go on this as Ehome start to exit the base. They throw down a trap, maybe looking for a couple of exit kills. How much are you willing to commit onto this? As you already see the Lushrak taking half his damage, or half his health in damage. They've got the BKB, but the Overgrowth comes in. D-Stone's going to be locked up. The Hookshot comes through. Razor locked in. Has the Static Link. Gets the kill on the D-Stones. He's going to be dead for 70 seconds without buyback. They'll take out the Lushrak. HYM. He's gone, as is Guevara, four heroes dead, just the Gyro alive. And Sirius, I don't know if I would have suggested going for that. And with that, they call GG. So I don't know if I would have suggested going for those exit kills like that. But that was the attempt they wanted to make, and they go for it. Ehome ends up winning the game off that because they don't have buyback, and they just tap out 30 minutes in. It was close. I mean, it was close. Look at this. And then boom, gone. That's it. So, I mean, Ehome take the victory. They get the 2-0. They secure a top two. Probably a tiebreaker. I don't know if that, how that's gonna work. If Vici do 2-0 LFS, unless they get 0-2, there's gonna be a tiebreaker of some sort. So we'll see. I have no idea. I'll have to ask. But yeah, I mean, look at this game again. Jin Q finding a lot of farm. 10,000 net worth in that four position. 5-2-16 involved in 21 of the 23 kills for Ehome. Definitely always involved in making his presence felt. So, does a really good job there. Ehome take the series 2-0. We'll be back with the final series of Vici versus Looking for Smile, or Look for Smile, in just a moment. I'm your caster, BCOP, at BCOP92 on Twitter. Follow me on Twitter to know when I'm casting and help me get that verified badge, hopefully. And we'll be back in just a moment. I appreciate you guys. Yeah, a lot. I'm glad to be here.